And here's your recap for Glensheen Mansion Murders Part 1. Glensheen Mansion.
Up north, up there.
East side.
West side.
Pretty in pink.
The rich go slumming.
Rochester, Minnesota?
No, it's Rochester, New York.
Teacher.
Lawyer.
Miner.
Money, money, money.
Politician.
Naturally.
Taconite mining.
Instant wealthy.
8-track.
Manilow.
Foul play.
6 degrees of Lisa sweatshirt.
It's the coldest winter I ever spent.
Was summer in Duluth.
Glenn Martin Sheen.
Saigon Hotel.
39.
Why not 40?
High tech.
Oh, that shower.
Christmas sleigh.
Taconite pennies.
William Henry Harrison.
Hey! Don't feel so good.
Elizabeth Congdon.
Caregiver.
Wolfie Wolven.
Almost.
John Cusack.
Victrola.
With candlestick.
On the landing.
With a pillow.
In the bed.
In case you can't tell by the name, Yikes Murder and Stuff contains themes that are not suited for children. It's also no good for the workplace and probably not your meemaw and your papaw either. We're going to talk about some grim subject matter, probably make uncomfortable jokes, and we're definitely going to be cursing. But if that's something you're into, then put your headphones on and hop in our nondescript windowless van and come see the puppies. Welcome back to Yikes, Murder and Stuff. Our theme music is by The Bad Man. TheBadManUSA.com.
This is episode 2 of the Glensheen Mansion Murders. It's such a long story because it's so much crazy going on. We had to make 3 parts of it. So I am Jennifer Sandwich.
I'm Lisa Sweatshirt.
And I'm Acadia Einstein.
Hey, yay! Back again. Awesome.
Main in the house.
Yeah. We are going to talk about the one major suspect for these murders that everybody pointed a finger at.
Ooh.
Now, normally when you're dealing with a murder, it's like a game of Clue. Who done it and what to do it with? But in this case, they zeroed in on one person. And that person's name was Marjorie Congdon LeRoy Caldwell Hagen.
That's the best name. Like, I love that name. I try to say Marjorie Congdon LeRoy Caldwell Hagen.
Yeah, there you go.
Holy crap. I can't say words over 4 letters long, but I can say that.
Congratulations. You did it, man.
Boom. I can't say philanthropy.
Yeah. Oh, shit. You did it again.
What is going on today?
No, pretty soon you'll be that talking Hershey's about candy legislature.
Bar. That Hershey's candy bar is
brand placement, everybody.
Got me smooth.
You hear me, Hershey's? We'll do this all day long if you want.
Oh, yeah, we will.
Give us a little money. So we are going to tell you a little bit about Marjorie Congdon, who was the daughter of Elizabeth Congdon, her first adopted daughter.
And the granddaughter of Chester and Clara Congdon.
That's right.
Not by blood.
Right. We're going to rewind a little bit, and we're going to tell you a little bit about Marjorie's stuff.
Yeah, because it's some fucked up stuff. That's why.
Yeah, so I'm going to tell you about her stuff. So Marjorie was born in 1932, adopted from North Carolina when she was 3 months old. She was noticeably a different child. She was not like her sister. She was very introverted, didn't have a lot of friends, kind of mean.
She was really smart.
Super intelligent.
Mm-hmm.
Extremely intelligent.
All the earmarks of a serial killer.
She went through her childhood just being a holy terror, basically.
Mm-hmm.
One story when she was in her teens is that she tried to kill her own horse.
Yeah, fucking bitch. Oh, I hate when they try to kill the animals.
Why do they do it?
I hate it.
Yeah, but I mean, to be fair, it wasn't like a cat. I mean, trying to kill a horse is a good fight.
It is. Right. It is. But she did not succeed, so F her. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, yeah, you know, I mean, she's not afraid of anything. She's pretty bold.
Nope.
So her and her friend rented horses from Skyline Stables. This is a thing? You can rent horses? I mean, just like go out there and rent a horse and ride around?
Yeah, probably. I don't think you could like take it to the mall, but
okay.
Yeah.
It'd be awesome.
It's not like renting a car. Like,
if she could, she would, I'm sure. This is at Skyline Stables, so Lisa knows where this is, and this is in her, in her old stomping around.
My old neighborhood.
So that's right, and that's where your grandma used to race down the road.
100 miles an hour to Barry Manilow.
To the country club. Yeah, which is right across the street from the Skyline, where the Skyline Stables used to be.
Yes, it is, actually. Yep.
Yeah.
Actually, where my junior high school used to be, or is now.
What is your junior high school name? Is it also a Congdon-named school, or is it...
No, actually, I did go to Congdon Elementary School.
Yeah!
So that's how rich these people were, is I went to their elementary school.
Yeah, they had schools named after them.
Yep, but Ordean Junior High School.
On the east side of town, of course.
On the east side.
Yeah.
East side.
You wouldn't do that in the west side.
No, no stables. Maybe a glue factory.
Right.
Just saying.
Well, sure. Marjorie's
That's where they made dog food.
Marjorie's gonna try to make some dog food here.
Yeah. So Marjorie's setting up some dog food for the heated dog house.
Apparently, at one point in time, she loved this Tennessee Walker horse that that was named Greyhound. And it was a difficult horse, required an experienced rider. She was a pretty good rider, apparently. And so when the stables closed down, Elizabeth bought that horse for Marjorie. Soon afterwards, Marjorie's like, oh, this fucking horse. Oh, my God. It's so big. It eats all the time. It's nothing but work. I do not want to fucking do this anymore.
I don't want to clean the poop up anymore.
I am not taking care of this fucking
horse. Can you just
horse.
Imagine what that fight sounds like between the mom and the daughter? Like, Marjorie, get outside and clean up after your horse. Mom, I'm writing with my quill pencil right now. You know,
right? But also, I gotta side with the kid. Oh, I have to take care of the horse, but you have someone whose job is to dust.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, well,
why did they hire a stable hand?
Get your shit in a sock, Mom.
Now what? Slam door. Fuck you. Yeah.
What the hell, man? So Elizabeth's like, all right, fine. We're just going to give away the horse to somebody who will take care of it, you know, or sell the horse to somebody, whatever.
Who will actually
you know?
Love it with real feelings.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Well, Marjorie did not take too kindly to this for whatever reason. She's trying to feed the horse oats with both hands, like trying to shove the oats into the horse's mouth. And this caretaker saw her and was like, Marjorie, that horse is not hungry right now, so, you know, maybe try to be nice to you because you are the daughter of my boss. And, you know, like, you know, so she gets surprised. She drops the oats and she runs away. The caretaker walks over to pick them up and sees there's like 30 or 40 pills on the floor mixed in with the oats.
Oh, my fucking God.
The caretaker runs and tells Elizabeth, and she's like, oh, thank you so much for telling me about my daughter.
Oh, yes, I knew the horse had a headache, but I think she gave him much too many ibuprofen.
We just won't speak on this anymore.
We'll never speak of this again. Good day to you, sir. Thank you so much. So,
here's a gold coin.
And you're fired.
Here's a piece of taconite right. for you.
Yeah.
Enjoy your taconite.
Heads up! Here comes the taconite!
Yeah, really.
She's found a new owner for the horse before Marjorie was able to kill it, right? So Marjorie basically was like, don't want to take care of this horse, but you know, I don't want anybody else to have it either, so fuck you, horse, I'm going to kill you.
I'm going to kill your ass.
Didn't work out for that, which is good. I'm happy for the horse. The horse is the...
Is the real winner here. Yeah.
Yeah. That horse lucked out to be able to get away from the family so quickly, so...
Also, but it was smart, though. She if you're going to try and kill a horse, that's the way to do it. Like, don't be like, oh, fucking strangle it.
Manual strangulation like will work on a gigantic horse.
Exactly.
If she kind of figured it out, I'm sure she would have done it.
Can you see her, like, I look at her as, like, Tina from Bob's Burgers, like, laying in bed going, how do you kill a horse?
Tina would never kill a horse.
No, she loves horses.
She loves horses, like,
she
almost.
She loves horses.
Tina loves horses in a way that you
nobody else
shouldn't love horses. It's just... Damn it, there's a show idea about a horse fucker. Maybe we'll talk about that one.
We'll save Tina for later.
Yeah. All right, so her teen years are going by swimmingly for a psychotic little teenager. And so she goes to these stores, to like department stores. She'll like go to like, I don't know, Macy's. I don't know what was up there, Marshall Fields or something at the time.
They had,
like,
I think they had a form of Macy's up there.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Saks
or
Fifth
Dayton's
Avenue.
Maybe.
Yeah. 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 So, which by the way is.
Every fucking area has its own like, oh, I only shop at Blogdorf's or
if
whatever the fuck
there's
it was.
Goddamn rich people to spend money, there's a fancy place for them to go to spend their money.
Yeah. And now they're all called Macy's.
Yeah, they're all called
Macy's. Which is funny because the Dayton's people are the people who own Target. And it also is the Mark Dayton is our governor.
Actually, I went to school. Yeah. My sister went to school with some of the Daytons.
Well, there you go. Yep.
That's at Congdon Elementary.
6 degrees of separation with Lisa.
Everybody in this fucking state knows me.
2 degrees. Yeah. It happens so often that Marjorie Congdon would walk into a store and be like, hey. I'm Marjorie Congdon. Give me some stuff. Put it on my mom's bill because she'll pay for it. And they're like, yeah, okay, cool. That's cool. Elizabeth, you know, your daughter came in here and spent $100 billion and said that you would go ahead and pay for it. Elizabeth just paid for it. You know, she just paid it. And then she's like, when you see my daughter, could you be like, no, I'm not selling you this? And all the stores are like, oh, yeah, that's cool. We'll do that. And then she'd go in and they'd be like, oh, sorry, I can't sell it to you. And then Marjorie would be like, here's a note from my mother saying that I could buy it.
That I'm allowed to buy a bunch of expensive things.
The sales clerk is like, okay, here's your 17 purses and your 16 pounds of makeup and your shoes and other shoes and the more shoes that you buy. Whatever it is that you're buying. So yeah.
These expensive, these is red bottoms, these is bloody shoes. Thank you, Cardi B.
Well, I didn't even know who she was until you had to tell me.
You know nothing, Jen, about anything. That's
I have heard. Start. Knowing about Cardi B is not such a bad thing. Not knowing about her is not such a bad thing. So she is nuts. She is going to Dana Hall, just like her mom's alma mater by Wellesley in Massachusetts. And she's continuing to have money management problems there, too. That's a really nice way of saying it, that she is, no matter how much money you give her, she is going to spend it all and go into debt.
Go into debt.
Yeah.
She's running negative all the time.
Oh, on everything, constantly. Well, her mom, Miss Elizabeth, ends up making an appointment and taking her to the Menninger Clinic in Topeka, Kansas. And this place was like a world-renowned psychological clinic back in the day. And she was diagnosed as a sociopath, psychopath. Total disregard for other people. Like, she was missing empathy completely.
This is when you bring her home, put her in a burlap sack, throw her just like that ring, that engagement
ring, right
into Lake Superior. You're fucking Rose Calvert, that bitch.
This dog bites. We got to put it down.
Titanic, this girl.
Oh, my God.
In a sack.
Yeah. Oh, well, she's just absolutely horrible.
Yeah.
I have no idea how old she is at this time, but it's like in 1951, which is just like two years later after she's diagnosed as being a fucking sociopath, a zero empathy machine. She marries this guy named Richard LeRoy. They called him Dick.
Mm-hmm.
We will refer to him as Dick LeRoy. Oh, my God. So they have 7 kids.
That's the... Yeah.
7 Boom. Kids.
Stick it to Marjorie.
That dick is just... Yep. What was his friends used to say about him, like, having all those kids? What did they say?
So he had, like, this coworker that asked him if as many children as they had, if he was... Because he was a good Catholic or a passionate Protestant. Yeah. And, like, he's like, I'm a passionate Protestant.
I'm just... giving it to her.
Yeah. He liked to bone her. You know?
Oh, man. Boning is good.
I'm sure later he was kind of like, well.
Yeah. Then it's just like, I don't want to bone anymore.
I don't.
Well, the first thing was things were fine for like 2 months, right?
They made it 60 days. Yeah. Without incident.
Then she buys a house without telling him. She's just like, well, here's a house. Moving in.
We're moving in.
Congratulations to us. This is great. He's like, okay. He had to call Aunt Elizabeth to bail out Marjorie.
Out of the house. Well, there was like a constant calling of Elizabeth to help bail out Marjorie. She had purchased this house and he had already told her the house was too expensive. They couldn't afford it. She signed some paperwork and now it's kind of, they're both like locked in. So he had to call Elizabeth for the down payment.
Oh, my God. Well, mm-hmm. of course they could afford it. I mean, the Congdons, right? So she's just, like, walking around with that name going, I can buy anything.
Well, with the mentality, yeah.
I mean, if she was in charge of that money, of that estate, that whole place would be burned to the ground right now. I mean, there would be nothing left.
Yeah.
Nothing for anybody.
Yeah. Nope. But it was made of steel, Jen.
Right. It's made of iron ore. Right. Taconite. Elizabeth actually went to, at this point, the Congdon estate was in the hands of like a board of trustees. Her mother had a trust set up for Marjorie's grandmother, Clara, and said, instead of waiting for her to turn 21, give her the trust that Clara had set up to her, which was an annual income of $8,000 pretty well for the rest of her life, right?
Yep.
That was $62,000 today is what that money is worth. And Marjorie still continued to spend beyond their means. Few years later, Marjorie gets another trust. She gets one from Elizabeth. That one is $25,000 a year. That's $260,000 today. We're well above $300,000 a year that she's getting on her own just for fucking being a just fucking Congdon.
For having a last name.
Yeah, just for being the dick that she is. And she's with her and Dick's salary together, they made well over $50,000 a year with the two of them, which is like $500,000 today.
Still in fucking debt.
Still in debt. To the tune of like $25,000, which is like $250,000 today.
Yeah, but because poor people like us...
We don't understand.
We've just got to buy McDonald's lunch tomorrow.
We're like, oh, wow, look, I have pants. And rich people have pants. They just cost 10 times as much and are 10 times better.
Right,
well,
yeah.
They can only wear those pants once. And then you got to get the new pants.
It's not like poor people are all... Like, if the way poor people talk about rich people, you would think that all the poor people would be rich in like an hour. Well, if I had $1 million, I would be a millionaire for 1 minute.
That would be me, too. I would immediately be like, I'd be running out trying to clone my cat.
Right, and it's gone.
I know, but I have 16 Stevens, so it would be amazing.
Yes.
I would be so happy.
Teach him to pull a plow.
Now I'll just let them all walk all over my face at 3 o'clock in the morning like they would totally
and
do.
Beg for snacks.
Let's love them so much. Where are we?
Marjorie started getting into antiques.
Oh, God. Oh, yeah. So she's an antique collector, right? She's going to buy some furniture. She's like, Dick, look, we need this furniture. It's super expensive,
like,
furniture.
Marge, no, we can't afford it for the 40 millionth time.
Plus, I'm sick of your bullshit.
Yeah, shut the fuck up, bitch. Plus, get in the car. Let's go to church.
Antique furniture is not comfortable.
We've got 7 kids. What's going to happen to this furniture, you know?
And then the old man Congdon's ghost is like, I just called it furniture.
And so she's like, all right. I'll get the kids in the car, and I'll be out in just a second. And just hang on out there for a little bit. I'll be right with you.
I got to get my scarf for my hair.
Yeah. He waits in the car, and it's like, God, man, she's taking a while. She's like, oh, okay, I'm here. I'm ready to go. Let's go to church. They go to church. They come back. They walk inside, and the fucking furniture is all cut up and torn up. Like, all of the living room furniture has been, like, sliced open. And she's all like, that's a bad dog we got there. Yeah, but there's some insurance on it and get some new
fancy
furniture.
Thank God we
got
the insurance, Dick, through the company you work for.
That's Jesus right, Acadia. Christ. She blamed it on the dog.
Well, it's amazing how the dog was smart enough to hit every single piece of furniture in that house. Like, he just didn't get the couch or the side chair. He took out every pillow, you know, side table. He ruined it all. Good for that dog.
So she ran around the house cutting up and damaging and ruining the furniture.
Allegedly.
Of course. Well, they waited in the car to go to church, so she must have been in there, like,
okay,
just running around just slicing shit up, you know?
Here's my question. She comes out to go to church. Not one feather was in her hair that anyone recognized? Not, like, one piece of evidence from the couch slicing? Like, imagine, you're slicing up your furniture in your house, You don't have like one feather from the stuffing on the inside?
You know, and maybe they're, maybe, who knows? What?
Yeah,
I mean, it's
just
such a,
saying.
It's just a
thing
one,
about.
Yeah, one thing, but maybe there was, and Dick was just like, oh, I'm kind of scared of her. I'm not going to say anything.
Yep, you know? That might be too. But she did file a claim with his the insurance company he worked for.
And she did get that fucking antique furniture.
Yep.
Yeah. So she's, you know, that, oh my God.
You know what she is? A winner.
She is a winner. Yeah.
All I do is win, win.
That's right.
But she doesn't. I mean, she can't win enough. Okay, I've got everything. I'm super rich. This is a wonderful thing. I need more. There's no enough for her.
There's no bottom to Marjorie's glass.
Mm-mm. 10 years later, she gets the rest of the full amount of the Clara Trust, which ended up being $288,000 in cash at the time, which is, okay, everybody sit down. Yeah. That is $2,158,021 today plus stocks.
Fucking insane. Insane. Right. Insane. But you have to remember, she also burned her garage down.
Yeah, oh, that's right. That's right. Yes, tell us about that, Lisa.
So one day, her daughter's like outside and like is like smelling some smoke. And she walks around. She's like, oh my God, the garage is on fire. So she runs in and she's like, ma'am, garage is on fire. And Marjorie's like,
Don't worry about it.
No, don't worry. It'll be okay.
Oh, it's okay.
She's like looking out the window that faces the garage. She's like, oh, don't worry about it.
She's just like sipping her tea. Like,
well, then the kid starts bugging her again. Like, it's the fire is coming out the windows. She's like, oh, just stop it. It'll be fine. Then after
She's just watching it burn.
Let it burn. Dick pulls up.
Burning down the garage.
No shit. Then Dick pulls up. There's fire blowing up everywhere. He somehow backs like the car away from the garage. Like, here's Dick risking his life. And he's yelling at the neighbors, you know, move your stuff away from our garage. The whole garage burns down. She collects insurance money.
Wow, she's great. She's just
crazy. How do you get insurance on a garage?
Rich people insure everything.
I think it was part of the homeowner's insurance.
Ugh.
She knows what's up.
I bet if she could cut off the tip of her finger, if they had like body part insurance, she'd certainly insure Dick and be like, make a turkey and like take out that big cleaver thing and be like, oops, cut off the tip of your pinky. How much can we get for that?
I would. Oh, but you know what?
I would do that too, honestly.
Yeah, but
I think she'd kill a kid.
I don't want to rain on your parade, but I would not do that if I were you, because you know the I do Castle Rock Historical Society with Hannah Selector, and she works at a law firm, and there is actually a table that has been declared by Earth as to how much your body parts are worth.
Oh, well, but you have to remember,
like, really?
Because, like, if you're working somewhere and, like, your arm gets cut off or something like that, it's not, like, unlimited, you know what I mean? They're like, this is how much your arm is worth.
Yeah, my dad's a workers' comp attorney, so there are parts that actually got a monetarial value to them.
I didn't know that. So the tip of your pinky probably isn't worth very much, is it?
Well, but in the 60s, though, this is the 60s. Shit was going crazy in the 60s. His little pinky flange could have been worth like millions.
Yeah, that's true. Goddamn hippies.
Right. Yeah, these people were not hippies. They were the opposite of hippies.
Yeah, but the hippies were the ones that were causing all the body part inflation.
Yep.
Let's see. This was the late 60s.
Yep.
She had her kids in skating, figure skating, right? Well, not hockey or...
Oh, no, it was
figure skating.
Right? She had all of them in figure skating. What is that called? Like, what? You're a soccer mom or something?
She's like a skater mom.
Yeah,
like,
big time.
Not cool skater mom, like skating mom.
She was a skater mom. I really hate her mom.
Right? She's pulling all of her bullshit with the people at the school with the skating, too. And Lisa, this is what you told me, Mom, because she's basically like a ragey sports mom. So she's kind of like one of those horrible moms that you'd see at Little League. Is like, fuck your kid. Your kid's stupid. She's like completely like that ragey sports mom who just hates everybody except for her kids. All the other skate moms there called her the carnival act. Quote unquote, the carnival act. So,
oh my God. They're like, oh God damn it. Here comes Marge.
She was like a sideshow freak show. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They had this. Oh, God. Lisa, you explain this better because I don't really understand, but they had a rule.
Oh, there was, I mean, just a bunch of things she did under the guise of skating was like one of her major things was is every time you'd get ranked, there would be like, let's say five kids skating. Those five skate against each other. And then you come up with three. Those three skate and you come up with first, second, and third.
Right.
Well, if Marjorie felt like her kid might not make it to the second tier, there was this rule that if your child was sick, it didn't kick you out of the competition. It just moved you to the next level the next weekend. So her kids were like...
Sure, because your kid can't help being sick. That's fair, right?
That's valid. However, you know, she found the loophole. She exploited it. She basically, her kids were sick all the time first tier and would automatically be moved to the second tier and wouldn't have to actually compete. I mean, competitors' skates went missing. She, like, Tanya Harding'd everybody. You know? Poor little kids crying. Like, why?
All these little Nancy Kerrigans.
Again, winner.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
Yep.
Yeah, she's going to win no matter what.
Oh, for sure.
So the funniest part is that there was a competitor's skates that, like, disappeared, apparently, and they were, like, scraped on gravel or something and ruined. And it was a kid who had been beating her son in a competition, and he used the skates that had been, like, run over gravel, and he tripped and fell and got a concussion. Her son, Steven, actually won the competition and went on to nationals.
On the poor little She's brain injury of another child.
Right, whatever it takes.
Yep.
So she wanted her kids to have, like, total access to the rink to practice at any time. And the school had, like, a truancy problem with kids going to skate instead of going to class. So they would ditch class.
Well, that's a fucking Minnesota-sounding problem.
Man, isn't it?
Oh, all these kids just keep ice skating instead of learning.
Call the truancy officer.
Oh, yeah, we got our problems here in Minnesota. Yeah.
Yeah.
So there's... Suddenly, like, this anonymous donor comes by and donates a bunch of money to the school. And the school's like, all right, kids, you can use rank anytime you want. But thank you very much, anonymous donor.
Well, no, it wasn't just, hey, kids, you can use the rank anytime you want. Hey, Congdon kids, you can use the rank anytime you want.
Oh, I didn't know that.
No, the Stevenson kids couldn't use the rink.
What?
No, nobody. The Hagen kids couldn't use the rink.
No.
Nope.
No, it was only the Congdon kids who could use the rink.
That's more fucked up than I even thought it was.
Oh, yeah.
I thought all the kids were going to be. Yeah, well, they don't have a truancy problem anymore because now the other kids need to go practice skating, but the Congdons are over there all the time. Great.
Yep. Yep.
She goes to a skating competition with her kids in Colorado for like 2 weeks. Oh, and I should say, too, that she's familiar with Colorado, too, because her granddaddy, Chesta Congdon, did a lot of business in Colorado. Probably dug a lot of holes.
There's a lot of mining going on in Colorado.
Yes. Yep. And so she's really familiar with the area. She's there for 2 weeks. She runs up a $2,000 hotel bill. She spent $8,000 on jewelry. While she was gone, her husband, Dick, found another bill at the same time for $10,000 at a jewelry store in fucking Minnesota. So she had racked up. So let's see, if $2,000 is worth 13, 14 grand today, she spent $20,000.
In 2 weeks.
I mean,
That's 10.
She spent like $150,000 of today's money in 2 weeks going on a school skating competition in Colorado. The fuck?
Men don't even spend that amount at a strip club.
No.
You know?
Well, fucking men that don't try hard.
Yeah, that's true.
Right. Well, if you're too poor.
Men who don't have gold-plated records don't spend that kind of money. But
in 2.5 years, this psycho...
Fucking
psycho? Bitch, yeah, she spent all the cash from the Clara Trust Fund. They had to sell off all their stocks to pay for her spending sprees. And Dick, like, conservatively, like, approximates her total spending during their marriage at like $1 million. But that would be like $8 million today.
Yeah,
but... Oh, so she was adopted at 3 months old. She had already won the fucking lottery.
Oh, man.
Well, whose fault is that then?
Not mine. Just poor people.
Well, yeah, no, not
everybody
yours.
On
you
the
weren't
website.
There.
No, I'm just kidding.
No, it was...
West Side Duluth's fault.
It always is.
It was the old lady's fault for being a bad baby picker.
Well, there you go.
I think somebody else picked the baby.
I think if you're going to adopt, you get a say.
There, you know...
They don't just hand you a bag and say, oh, you don't open it until you get home.
I don't know if it was olden days. She was just probably like, give me the best baby you got. And they're like...
We found this one at the fire station.
You're going to have a hard time getting rid of this one. We'll just...
They get the baby. She's like, you're fine. Give me another baby. And then all of a sudden, Jennifer or Susan shows up.
She's like, oh, this is a better baby.
I like this baby.
Yeah, but didn't Dick say something about... Didn't he say something about, like, he had contacted Elizabeth at some point in their marriage and was like, do you know anything about her birth mom? Because she's fucked up.
God, it was something about she was a teacher, but at the time when they finally found her, she was in jail for stealing money from her employer.
I think it's so telling that he went to Marjorie's mother and said, something is really wrong with your daughter.
Elizabeth had kind of prompted and pushed Marjorie to be honest with Dick prior to the marriage. She's like, better tell him about your hospital stay and what your diagnosis is.
Oh,
and she
kind
of sold it to him like a car salesman. She's like, my mom wants me to be too perfect because we're a wealthy family. So she sent me to a sanitarium and they said this, but they really just wanted a diagnosis. So I think everybody was just hysterical and confused and they were just trying to, you know, whatever. I got out and I'm good. Marry me.
2 months
Let's
later.
Have 7 kids.
Yep. Yeah. And I'm going to squander every dime that you make.
Well, and like Elizabeth bailed them out to the tune of today's money, $3 million.
Yeah. Yeah. That
on top of the $8 million she had already spent. And an interesting thing, this is another thing, because I had mentioned this in the first one, you're going to find out something about a painting. There's this like painting Elizabeth like loved that was in there. I think it's above the fireplace in the library. I think one day it just sort of disappeared. I don't have a lot of dates. It's just a little bit of a story I remember from all the reading doing. But this painting, just like Marjorie came to visit. She left, like, let's say on a Sunday. And then on Sunday evening, everyone's like, where'd the painting go? Above the fireplace. You know, it's always coincidental. You know, Marjorie just sort of slips out of town. They don't call the police because they basically know it's Marjorie.
Right.
And so they start looking into art dealers, like around the Minneapolis, St. Paul, Duluth area. They find a dealer who actually had bought the painting off of Marjorie, and then he had actually sold it to somebody else.
Oh, my God.
And Elizabeth went and purchased the painting back.
What?
It was never spoke of, and it's now still in the house today. When you go on the tour, there's a painting in one of the rooms above a fireplace that was stolen, sold to an art dealer who then sold it to a customer who then Elizabeth was like, yeah, my shit-ass daughter sold the painting we didn't want. Put it in the garage sale box by accident. Can I buy that back from you?
Oh, my God.
And they're like, yeah, no problem. But she had to buy it at a higher rate than what it was worth, and it's hanging above the fireplace now. She's just a piece of shit.
She is. She just ruins everything. She's just a ruiner of... Ugh.
Leave her alone.
I hate her.
Leave Marjorie alone.
I hate her.
I don't like her. I hope she hears this. Dick had set up a trust for kids and from the Clara money.
You know, when the Clara trust came to fruition for Marjorie, Elizabeth got scared and called Dick and it's like, I'm going to send this check in the name of you, Dick, and you're going to take care of the money because I want you to set up trust for my grandkids,
right.
Please.
Yeah.
And, you know, and so he did that when Marjorie's son and Marjorie and Dick's son, Andy, went to go apply for college. He went to go get $5,000 out of his trust. And that's what it was meant for.
Okay. Yeah.
They found Marjorie had emptied all the accounts and spent all the money.
Winner.
Man, that's...
This woman is just ballsy, you know, just... forged documents. And still, think about this. She's burning garages down. She's trying to kill horses. She's stealing paintings. All these are jailable offenses.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, but she ain't in jail.
Nope. No, because the Elizabeth was so worried about protecting the Congdon name. I think this is just this reinforcement of this bad behavior is just why she gets really mental.
Yeah, well, Dick leaves her. Dick fucking divorces her after almost...
Who the hell would
20 it? Years, you know what I mean? He divorces her. And he doesn't cite irreconcilable differences. Oh, no, no. He cites cruel and inhumane treatment as a reason for getting divorced. So...
That poor guy.
Yeah.
That poor guy.
So he's finally out. He's out. He survives. He's gone.
He's like moving out of house. There's like a marching band behind him, like da 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 da.
Yeah. The sun's shining on his face. Yeah. Everything's just
the sun comes out, the birds sing.
It's a good day for good old Dick LeRoy.
Mr. LeRoy.
Yeah. Marjorie's not done yet, but she's got a lot of life in her. It's 1974 now. Mm-hmm. She had coerced Elizabeth into co-signing a $345,000 loan from Marquette National Bank of Minneapolis. I think we know right where that is.
I know exactly where that is.
I don't.
Well, it's like right downtown.
Yeah, it's right across the street from your dad's place, pretty much.
Oh, yeah, that is funny. Yeah. It is. It is literally right across the street.
So, 2 degrees of separation. So,
everywhere.
So, apparently it was like by duress and like false pretenses. Marjorie pretty much admitted doing this because she was sued by Elizabeth Congdon or by the Congdon estate in 1975. She's still just trying to get money from her mom, and the estate's trying to cut her off. November of that same year, Marjorie goes and visits Elizabeth again and says, "Hey, I made some homemade marmalade. Would you like to have a sandwich made of this?"
Oh, and Elizabeth is diabetic.
She's diabetic.
And it's actually Velma who's like, "Your mom's diabetic. You can't give her marmalade." And
that nurse.
Marjorie's
especially
like...
Especially marmalade with green cartoon smoke coming out of it. Like, come on!
Filled with acid. You can't give her that, Marjorie.
For fuck's sake.
For whatever reason, she insisted. And Elizabeth finally was like, "Oh, all right, I'll eat it. You know, I'll have a bite or whatever." And the next thing you know, Elizabeth is found unresponsive in bed
in a coma.
You don't
yeah,
say.
And so she goes to the hospital, and they found all kinds of sedatives in her system.
No
charges are filed, as the sandwich and the marmalade in the house were never found. So apparently there was some sort of investigation, but it was not pushed.
There was definitely a rule after this, like, nobody leave Marjorie alone with her mother. There was a strict rule of this after that.
Like, that's a great...
You know?
Also, I can't believe the crack squad of detectives could have... It was a fucking sandwich. Like, you could literally throw it just, like, 2 feet away and no one would ever find it if you were outside.
Right. Lake Superior. Okay,
Jesus,
nobody...
look at this... I couldn't find the sandwich, but I found a sleepy as fuck dog. I don't know.
I couldn't find the sandwich, but look at this fucking engagement ring I found in Lake Superior.
Right?
You know?
Oh,
Fred Wolman's ring has been found.
Oh, sidebar. After her divorce to Dick LeRoy, she is dating this dude, Mike Billings, for a couple years, and then they're breaking up, right? He comes over to the house to pick up some of his stuff, and he sees her like putting shit in the garage, and he's like, "Oh, there she is. I don't want her to see me, so I'm just gonna slowly back out." And he's like,
"I just like the visual I have of this." He's like bent down behind the steering wheel,
yeah, like
slowly backing out of the driveway,
like, out real slow.
"Please, for the love of God, don't let her see me.
Yeah, she didn't, but that he finds out later that day that she burned the house down.
The house burned down like the next day.
All of her stuff was...
What she was moving was personal items. So it was like her kids' skating trophies and family pictures and things like that. But she left all the other furniture and all the crap that was worth money, burnt everything down. kept the memorabilia, and went back to the insurance company.
That's right. And the house was insured for $430,000. I'm not even going to go into how much that's worth because I just don't want to be angry anymore.
I'm over being angry so at she what had, a like, pile of poo.
She owed this dude like a bunch of money for remodeling because they bought the house together. She wasn't charged at the time because the insurance had lapsed and she didn't realize it and she burned the house down. But apparently at the time, if you burn your own house down, you don't have insurance. That's cool. You could do it.
There's no crime.
It's your house. You can burn it down, whatever. Fine. So she didn't even get any money for it. So she just burned down a house for no fucking reason. She's like, this poor Mike dude is just probably like, oh, fuck. I'm washing my hands of it. I'm out of here.
Mike probably could have used the money. Marge is like,
yeah.
Fuck it.
Yeah.
See ya.
Yeah. Oh, fuck. She's horrible. Okay, so even a little bit later on, so she kind of rotates between like Minnesota, Colorado, Arizona, Washington, Florida. Those are all like places where Chester Congdon did business. So she,
well, there's a castle in Washington.
That's right. That's her winter castle or whatever. Yeah, one of the many castles. But she apparently might have started a couple fires at the Inglewood, Colorado Bank, First National Bank of Inglewood.
Yeah, I kind of didn't get this.
Yeah,
one.
It's like so they there must have been maybe she was denied a loan.
They must have done something to her.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. So, but apparently they saw her in the vicinity, and then there was a fire that was started, and a janitor put it out. And I guess it happened again, like the next day.
She tried to do it twice. She had been spotted in the area and all sorts of stuff.
Yep. That again, mm-hmm. No proof. Can't do anything. So
no jail.
Well, it is 1976. We got some Bee Gees going on the radio. Andy Gibbs cool.
He's hot.
Oh, so hot. Oh, so we got some Sean Cassidy happening.
Ooh.
Ooh la la, indeed. Silken pants time era. They didn't care or know anything about any of this, apparently. She's living in Colorado now, 1976. And she's I'm feeling a little lonely. I think I'm going to go to this parents without partners meeting. It just sounds like so sad. It's just like, would you like to go meet other sad people? Come to parents without partners. Maybe your children will find a mother or a father that you need.
Hey.
And come to a resume.
It worked for the Brady Bunch.
It did. It actually did. This is in Colorado where she's living now. She meets Roger Sipe Caldwell. His middle name is like S-I-P-E. It's just a weird...
Oh, my God.
It's almost like Snipe from the Harry Potter movies that I didn't see. Right?
No. So, no, that's Snape.
Snape. Oh, damn. God, I'm terrible.
See? You haven't seen it. You should never reference movies you have not seen.
That's true. I'm going to not
Professor
do that
Snape.
Anymore. Professor me, no reference movies anymore. Okay, done. So his name's Roger Sipe Caldwell. And they get married 2 months later after they meet.
I'm in a hurry.
It must have been love.
I need... Listen... Is where we, you got a lot of kids, and you've got money.
Let's you're pretty cute.
Let's have it.
You're looking pretty good. Know it.
Let's have it.
I like that you wear a lot of turquoise.
You ain't seen nothing yet.
So Roger's a severe alcoholic, and she's all like, I'm an heiress, and he's like, okie doke. Sounds like a match made in heaven.
Oh. I mean, I'm also very, very understated. I'm not like loud like those other boys.
Do you think when he went to the Parents Without Partners meeting, he was actually heading to like an Alcoholics Anonymous and got confused?
I went into his, no, and he almost was like, not,
stumbles into an heiress and he's like, this is the best day of my life.
I was too drunk to leave, so
I had really
I just
pissed my
stayed,
pants.
I stayed, and then the MILFs came in. So
I thought, hell, why not?
Mm-hmm. I'm glad you stayed, Roger, because We got a lot of life left in us. So
we're going places.
She and Roger start living the rancher lifestyles. Marjorie is like, you know what? That one horse when I was a kid, it's a good horse. I want to do that again.
Even though I wanted him dead.
I'll get you all the horses you want, baby, and they'll have skinnier necks just in case you want to, you know, get rid of them.
Well, you know that, Roger. I'm going to buy you the nicest clothes, anything you want.
You mean I can have a suit, but not a suit, with really dark outlines on the lapels and everything?
That's right. And you can have...
And a metal tie.
You can have a cowboy hat and some boots to match. And
what is it? What's a ranch? What do we do on a ranch?
Oh, I guess we farm horses because
I don't like horses, so I'm gonna be the boss of the people who boss the horses. That will leave me once removed from
one step.
The horses, and that's
one step
fine.
Away. All right, it's a deal. Roger and Marjorie are going to be ranchers now, and Roger starts dressing the part so much so they used to call him the turquoise cowboy.
Oh, my God, him in that effing turquoise. He wore turquoise everything.
Right?
Like, hey. Bands around his hat, necklaces,
what is it,
bracelets.
What do you want,
call
Roger?
It blue taconite.
He's just trying to fit in. Oh, you know that you can tell how people are wealthy is when you wear a lot of turquoise. That's
number
one.
That just screams class.
Yep.
This is rancher rich means lots of turquoise and cow skulls.
Rancher Roger.
Arrayed around the yard.
Rancher Roger. I love it. And he's a scared of horses, which is the best part.
I'm the boss of the people who boss the horses. Just remember that.
And they're got to buy this ranch, right? It's only $750,000, which is $3 million today. Marjorie knows that she can't ask the trustees for any money. So she's like, Roger. Hey, Roger.
What?
I need you to do me a favor. Allegedly, I'm going to ask you to fly to Duluth and go ask for money.
Oh, meet my mom for the first time. And ask her.
So
ask her if we could have $3 million, because I want to build a home for the new greyhound horse I'm gonna get.
Greyhound okay. Two.
I'll do it. She'll make money on this deal. Just send me. Let's go.
She's gonna love you, Roger. And here's your bottle of rum, so you can make sure to get good and liquored up on the plane ride.
That's also you can just smoke on planes, and there weren't even seatbelts.
You're gonna be fine, Roger.
It'll be all good. Just get on the toot. Oh, that's the other thing. Whenever you get wasted, he called it being on the toot.
So, oh my God, we know about toots.
Yeah,
we go on toots all the time.
We're on toots. Roger's on toots.
That's right.
Marjorie's sending him to meet her mom for the first time on a toot.
We don't go by ourselves, though. I mean, we go with each other.
Yeah.
That's the difference, though. So,
we don't toot alone.
Go on a toot. No, we toot together. We're the friends that toot together.
Stay together.
Just keep on tooting. So he goes up there and flies up there and meets with Elizabeth in the library. He's never met her before, and he's pretty much like, well, thank you, Roger, for coming, but the answer is no. Have a good day. Goodbye.
Wait a minute. You didn't give me a chance.
I didn't give you
a chance.
I'm sorry. Sorry, Roger. How to go?
Some people, no. This is what I told her. You could say I want $750,000 for a ranch, but what I'm saying is, I need $750,000 to buy $3 million worth of horses that we're then going to sell. And some of that profit is back to you.
Oh, that's awesome.
So it's really an investment. Also, my tie is a string.
I hypnotize you with my turquoise bolo.
Don't you see how wealthy I am and how well I manage my money by how I dress? Notice the turquoise.
But by looking around, now I realize, why didn't we just live here? Because it's better We've made mistakes.
We got problems.
You mean you could just come live in this fucking mansion with an old lady that can't even bother you?
But no, Marjorie's more, she's got to do things her own way. There's no, like I said, there's never enough money. It gets even worse. Roger has to go again. But
no, it's only met her once. He goes that one time, he gets turned down, and then he never goes back.
That woman doesn't understand business is why.
This is 1977. This is the same year that the murders are going to take place. The Congdon estate had like a summer home, not a castle, I guess, but another summer home on.
Our house had a baby.
This one, let's make it clear. This one's in Wisconsin.
In Wisconsin, yeah.
Yep.
So, but this is up in upper Wisconsin in the Superior area. It's two doors down from this house on the Brule River in Wisconsin is a house called the Van Evra Lodge. And this is a house that's owned by one of the Congdon estate trustees.
Coincidentally, shortly after, Elizabeth said, no, you can't have the money for the ranch.
It's May of the same year that he'd asked for. Yep.
Yep.
Two doors down from that house is the Van Evra Lodge, and that's owned by one of the Congdon estate trustees who had just turned Roger down for the money that he was asking for on behalf of Marjorie so that they could live that rancher lifestyle. The staff noticed that the Van Evra Lodge had been broken into. The two staffers were female, and they were kind of afraid to go in, so they locked up the house and went back to wherever. They were going, and a male staff came back the next day, and the house was unlocked again. They think that the person who had broken into the house had been hiding in the house the day when the ladies' staff was there. The two staff members immediately said,
it's Marjorie.
It's her. They had found a partially burnt pillow from inside of the house as if someone had tried to start a brush fire. And I think you know what this estate looks like, that it was like kind of like on a hill.
The summer home, the lodge was on the top of a hill. So like if the brush would have started where the pillow was found, if the brush started fire, it would have swept up the hill and burnt the house down. If it would have caught, it would have burnt it down a matter of half an hour.
They thought it was a probable attempted arson, but of course didn't really get to prove that. 1 week after this, which is just 3 weeks prior to Elizabeth's death, guess who flies to Duluth again to talk to Van Evra, the trustee of the Congdon estate, to ask for money?
Is it me?
It is you, Roger.
Okay.
Well, Roger, you have some turquoise balls to do that. I'm telling you, like, fuck it out.
That's right. My balls were turquoise because, you know, she was all fucked up from the first guy.
This is pretty bold after the Van Evra estate had been tampered with. Roger goes up there and is basically like, so about that money.
So listen, I just found a guy that'll buy the horses for more. So now your money will be quintuple. So give it up.
And Marjorie sounds like a...
Hey, did you move that lamp?
Yeah. That lamp wasn't there last week.
So of course the trustees like Van Evra's like, no, get the fuck off my property. So
don't you just picture that guy as like having like a green eye shade thing and those like those things that you tie around your upper sleeve for some reason?
Right. Yeah, like a
I'm a trustee. You're not gonna have any of this.
No, get the hell off my property. 3 weeks later, Elizabeth and Velma are murdered. 3 weeks later, after Roger's second visit to Duluth.
Yep.
The family is so, it's just immediately, as soon as this happens, everybody in the family's like, boom, Marjorie, boom, Marjorie, Roger, Marjorie. It's
Marjorie.
These two.
Marjorie did it.
These two motherfuckers. So much so they were convinced that Marjorie had something to do with it. Like, one of these family members in Colorado, like, lived out there, like, in that same state as they did. He hired a bodyguard to protect himself and his family against Marjorie.
Yeah, because he was one of the trustees, too.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so he's like, well, he almost burnt down the other trustee's house. They flew all the way to Wisconsin for that.
Right.
Why wouldn't they, like, walk on over to my place and murder me in my sleep?
Maybe if you had built your houses of iron, you wouldn't be worried about it.
Made of taconite.
Nobody learned shit from Chester Congdon, man. Nobody learned anything.
The fourth pig used iron.
Yeah, there you go. And he lived.
That's why you don't hear him in the story.
All right. Well, wrap this up.
At the bottom of part two. Wow.
We are. So we're done with part two. Yeah.
Well, I don't know. I mean, this was a whole episode from about a psycho bitch.
Crazy, 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 crazy fucking bitch.
Yep.
It was character assassination at the highest levels.
No.
That's what this was. Because I found one picture of Marjorie where she looked kind of hot.
What?
No.
Therefore, she's absolved.
Oh,
yeah, but it was like her high school picture.
What?
Oh, well, we're gonna put hot Marjorie in the show notes. I never saw a hot picture of Marjorie.
No, every picture I just see of her was dead eyes.
Kinda.
I said kind of.
Okay.
You know?
But my bar is pretty low, so.
Yeah, when you go adding Congdon estate money to that, she gets really, really
pretty.
Oh, yeah.
Real fast.
Very attracted. I'm attracted.
I had the fucking goggles on from day one.
You never took them off.
That's right.
Well, in our third episode, we're going to talk about Marjorie and Roger's arrest, the trial outcome, and guess what? That's not even the end of the story.
It keeps going after this shit.
It keeps going. So that's why we had to have three shows on this. So please come back next week for the final part. And
still no tagline.
Still no catchphrase.
Still.
Got nothing.
Nothing.
So, okay, so here's your recap for part three, the Glensheen Murders. So
thank you.
Bye.
Roger.
On the toot.
Breakdown.
Bumbling Roger.
Suicide.
Bad luck, good luck.
Birthday cake.
No marmalade.
Alzheimer's.
In a coma.
Sentencing.
Double suicide.
Roger number two.
Took your money.
Caldwell's daughter.
Like father, like daughter.
Insurance.
More payouts.
Outcome.
Winning.
Yeah.